Ik open deze zitting met gebed. Mag ik de collega hoogleraren vragen hun cap af te nemen? Mogen de geest van wijsheid en barmhartigheid in ons allen groeien en tot volle wasdom komen. Gaat u zitten, dames en heren. Welkom to all of you. Special welcome to Anna, to Alexander and to Mrs. Rajkovic. And also to the ambassador of South Korea, Mr. Jung-Yoon Chu. Ladies and gentlemen, we have gathered here to listen to the inaugural speech of Professor Nikolas Rajkovic, who holds the chair of international law at Tilburg Law School, starting at the beginning of this year. A freshman, we would call it. In his research, Professor Rajkovic addresses the question of how international organizations, states, and non-state actors compete to impose different types of international legal laws and rules in the context of an increasingly globalizing world. From his credentials, we can only conclude that Professor Rajkovic is a man with a broad international orientation, in every sense of the word. He was born in Canada. He graduated from the universities of Harvard and Kent, and he obtained a PhD from the University of Florence. He obtained awards and distinctions from institutions all over the world, including Toronto, Budapest, and Kyung-hee, which explains probably your presence, Excellency. He lives in Brussels. His partner is Polish, and now he works in Tilburg, another big city. Professor Rajkovic, ladies and gentlemen, speaks many languages next to his native language, and I can mention here Serbo-Croat, Polish, and Italian, just to name a few. And he promised to learn Dutch within 4 years. And the starting time was the beginning of this year, which leaves you 3.5 years, if I am correct. That's a type of beta joke, as we call it. Professor Rajkovic deals with different worlds easily, which is apparent from what I just mentioned. Especially the network from Harvard has proven to be very successful and also a treasure to the law school here in Tilburg. His interdisciplinary approach fits very well into the tradition of Tilburg University. Professor Rajkovic succeeds to combine seamlessly international law and international relations in his work, which is very good. Before he joined us, we already knew from his reputation that he was a very capable and award-winning teacher. But what we hear from the students is truly flabbergasting. You seem to be an excellent and fascinating teacher, and especially the use of PowerPoint presentations seems to be extraordinary, which is a groundbreaking revolution for the law school. Ladies and gentlemen, I can only say that I'm very, very proud to have such a talent joining our university, and I'm very much looking forward to your presentation, Nick, which has the title, The Transformation of International Legal Rule and the Change of Interdisciplinarity. The floor is yours, Nick. And good luck.
Thank you.
His Excellency, Mr. Ambassador. Kind and esteemed rector, respected dean and vice deans of the law school, distinguished head of departments, esteemed colleagues, dearest friends, and finally, my beloved family, both here and abroad. Exactly 1 year ago this evening, in fact, I learned with great happiness of the honor to become the chair of international law at Tilburg University. Tonight is an even rarer and most enjoyable privilege, and I thank the university for giving me this unique moment and audience where I get to share my outlook on a vastly new type of international legal order before us, and the implication this has for the still evolving 140-year-old discipline called international law. So, without further ado, my presentation begins this evening with the most simple and radical of beginnings. And it is this iconic image, familiar to everyone in this auditorium. And I add to this image two powerful words that many of you will attach to it, perhaps intuitively. The first word, the globe. This spherical mass that constitutes and symbolizes an absolute materiality. The second word, a seeming imposter, globalization. It entered the Merriam-Webster's dictionary only in 1961. And while the database ISI Web of Science reveals that there are over 8,900 citations, this term has had a troubled career negotiating its definition ever since. Yet curiously, Hannah Arendt, who never had access to this term globalization in her 1958 book, The Human Condition, perhaps gave the best ontological clue on the meaning behind its semantic birth. Open quote. In 1957, an Earth-born object, Sputnik, made by man, was launched into the universe, where for some weeks it circled the Earth. This event is second in importance to no other, not even the splitting of the atom. The immediate reaction was relief about the first step toward escape from men's imprisonment to the Earth. And this statement has been carved in the funeral obelisk for one of Russia's greatest scientists. Open quote. Mankind will not remain bound to the Earth forever. Close quote. These themes of escape and unbounding define the register of this inaugural today. My chief purpose is to help international lawyers rediscover the depths of agency and genesis involved in our mappings of the globe, and correspondingly, the misplaced concreteness we have invested in an image. To appreciate that this iconic image here is as much an artifice as it is state of nature, and how we as international lawyers have been actively and passively involved in the naturalizing of a singular geological and geographical map as perceived objective or quote-unquote scientific geography. How could that be problematic, you ask? Well, what if I were to tell you that the fixed geometric map that we have all been dealing with has helped is encountering what quantum mechanics calls decoherence. In plainer English, the process at which an absolute model or measurement begins to lose its applicability or stickiness in relation to its object or subject of reference. Plainer still, this so-called world map that we have used in the discipline and in international relations and international law studies, which has been modeled and scaled geometrically, is breaking down. And not unlike earlier cosmographical maps, which have lost relevance previously in human history. Shocking to hear that, isn't it? The Enlightenment narrative of progress inscribed in our minds that scientific maps reflect an eternal reality rather than just highly sophisticated mythology of the temporal present. So let me be clear. What I speak about today isn't caricature postmodernism, and it isn't caricature constructivism. It is deeply material, real, policy relevant, and yes, of great practical legal concern. When established cartography unravels in the face of mounting non-conforming practices, so also break down our doctrinal, policy, and normative structures that are tied to a now defrosting territorial representation of the globe. So, international lawyers have tried to grasp these changes with a particular new vocabulary, They've talked about fragmentation, deformalization, and pluralism. Yet the shortcoming of that vocabulary has been the failure to see that international law is a field entwined in a complex knowledge ecology, or what I simply referred to as interdisciplinarity. And the spatial challenges that international lawyers struggle with are not unique. They have deeper roots in onto-epistemological questions that contemporary physics, geology, and geography have been at the forefront of grappling with in, yes, their empirically distant work, but no less ontologically insightful. So my aim in the next 35 minutes is a radical and interdisciplinary critique of the fixed geometric materiality that international law continues to unreflectively rely upon and socially reproduce. And my critique has three general moves. First, I will excavate how the geometric and scientific map came to quietly entrap the geographic vision and materiality of international lawyers. Second, I update that impoverished cartographic and terrestrial narrative by introducing two crucial and interrelated notions that international lawyers can no longer ignore. How the quantum materiality of the globe's geography has been made actual via an under-acknowledged Anthropocene. And third and finally, I will help illustrate this new materialization of the globe by looking at how the interactivity between the Anthropocene, drone robotics, and digitalization have brought about a pivotal transformation in legal geography and rule, where doctrinal jurisdictions now appear to be mutating into what I will propose to you today is juriscapes. So, first things first. To be able to convince you about my argument on cartographic and geographic decoherence, this requires a short and interdisciplinary history on the making of geometric coherence in international law. Clearly, geometry, geometrization, materiality are ordering terms not common to the canon or syllabi of international law. Humorously, we might say that has something to do with bad experiences with science classes in high school, perhaps. More seriously, this is justified by a different kind of map. The functional differentiation of knowledge. And it's a kind of geography that has naturalized a scholarly division of labor based upon what historical sociologists call objective qualities. So the idea is that cases and treaties appear to objectively belong to lawyers or international lawyers, while the subject of space seems to intuitively belong to geographers, physicists, astronomers, right? And it's upon these different cleavages that we're able to develop different stories about what we do in our disciplines. So, in the case of international law, the fact that something such as geometry or space is not typically within our field leads us to tell a story about the genesis of international law, usually with this parade of usual suspects. We're all familiar with the Peace of Westphalia, right? The beginning of international law is certainly tied to this iconic image of how the field emerges. Or how about this? The semantic birth of the field, right, with Vattel's notion of the law of nations. But of course, at some point we had to acknowledge that there was European imperialism involved in all of this, and we've come to acknowledge that as well. But that is also in our storyline changes to say, well, things are different now with the United Nations. What I want to tell you is a different story, a geometric story, the story of the geometrization of the field and how important the map becomes for understanding what is reality, actuality, and materiality appeal. So where I would begin is here, not a popular figure, even within political theory, but for international law, it's quite crucial. Niccolo Machiavelli's assertion that when you think about space in the world, you think about the state, and that the state is the primary ontological unit at which we start to look at the terrestrial reality of the world. But there was a problem. One of the important features of the state as a concept was that there would be an assertion of an inherent boundary. But in that point in time, establishing an apparent boundary was a problem. Enter this figure, Nicholas Copernicus. Again, not common fare in the history of international law, and sure to shock many. It was Copernicus' assertion of the geometric globe combined with the state as the primary spatial unit, which became very significant for the following reason. When it's geometric, it's finite. And when it's finite, you can measure it. This unleashed what I would propose, and I've talked, and my students have heard time and time again, was the birth or the makings of the scientific map. Now, we all know the narrative of this. It's the age of discovery. The crucial part that we often miss is that this was, in fact, for lack of a better term, the making of world real estate law. Because with the assertion of the state as the primary ontological unit, with the geometric globe asserted that gives you the potential to measure and to assert a concrete materiality, you arrive at a fundamental representation of the world which carves up what is supposed to be the central focus, that is, the terrestrial surface of the Earth. Now, this became accelerated even further with the formalization of the discipline of geography. And here it's quite important to look at this slide. Humboldt, who was central in the formation of geography as a discipline, the measuring of the Earth's environment, the reporting of the landscape, the systematic representation of the landscape, a very terrestrial, territorial making of the world and how we see it. The outcome is this. It's what we refer to as international lawyers, and it hangs in every school of the world for all intensive purposes. 200 discrete states with fixed borders, and we tell our students, both in this university and beyond, that this is the world, this is the globe. It's based on two points of materiality. The first is the 150 square kilometers of geology, physical geology. And the second part is the less than 500 kilometers of borders, or what Donald Trump likes to call walls. And it's these two types of materiality which put together, which we say this is the globe. I want to present to you a different understanding of it. And it's based on a different understanding in terms of what we've learned from the gift that quantum mechanics has given us. Following from this map, these are the rules of international law. And these are the rules which we tell our students matter because of this geology that we say is significant and the borders tied to it. Quantum. What quantum mechanics tells us, and what I propose is an interesting development in research that should be pursued in quantum geography, is the idea that there isn't just one materiality. There are many, and in fact, there are potential materialities. Now, this might sound quite abstract to you, but the map that I'm going to show you that has been developed by geologists is already giving us a clue as to the significance of just saying there is one materiality versus potential materialities. The Anthropocene. This is the map that should be hanging in the walls of International Law and Relations Department and in the schools themselves. And the Anthropocene is about us, what we have done to the surface of the Earth. And now pay attention here. This map is a combination of different things that I'm going to break down to you. It's based on population intensity. It's based on light pollution. It's based on the shipping lanes. It's based on energy pipelines, roads. It's all a bit confusing, but it's condensed. But I'll break it down for you to understand the significance of what the Anthropocene means in terms of understanding space in international law. The first one is this. If we take terrestrial mass out of our focus and focus on people, this is actually the map of the world. And India is in the center of it. Europe's over here, North America over here. But a world that focuses on human populations and subsequently looks at the significance of those demographics looks very different from the map of 200 discrete states in the world. Further still, there's another type of geography or materiality that we need to take into account. That map of all those people, two-thirds of them will live by 2030 in 40 megacities of the world. And those 40 megacities will have links of communication, commerce, trade between them. It's an interesting concept. We often talked about city-states in the early European history. We might be back to it in a global sense, but that doesn't show up on the map of 200 states. Further still, the undersea cables, the globe of energy pipelines. Notice where they're positioned. Notice where they distribute energy to. The shipping lanes and air routes. These are all things that you don't see in that classical map of the world. The global railway networks. Now, the important part here is to pay attention to an underknown to a fact that is little known, that in fact the railway networks are the basis upon which fiber optic cables are being laid. And so watch what happens when I change this picture to the next one. That's the flow of internet traffic. It largely reflects the railway grid. Changing materialities, each and every one of these pictures. But this is going back to Hannah Arendt, right? And this is, in fact, an artist's representation, but it also, you might have wondered what that very first slide that you saw up, where you saw this kind of globe with little objects around it. That is actually a mapping of the 2,200 satellites which are in orbit around the Earth. And so, going back to Hannah Arendt, we can't possibly talk about the reality or materiality of international law and international relations without realizing that the colonization of orbital space profoundly changes everything. It changes everything because it provides technologies and means of extraterritorialization that have been unknown previously. All right, we've looked at geophysical materialities. I want to talk about the materialities of people. And what happens now when we start getting more flexible about what we think geography is, what we think practical geography is, and how we understand that there are potential materialities. So, problem solving. If we look at a mapping of income distribution in the world, a geometric approach to mapping has been as follows. Low income, follow the yellow dots. High income, follow the blue dots. Now, what if we were to translate this into a completely different representation that is not concerned with the parameters and the fixed scale of territoriality? This is people living in poverty in the world, right? And this is an illustration via a cartogram of the scale, the chronic and the systematic nature of it. If you deal with geometric reality, you're not going to pick this up. Next, infant mortality of under 4-year-olds. 4 million children a year die, 11,000 a day. This is where it's happening. You're not going to appreciate the scale of what is occurring by mapping it the geometric way. Gross domestic product, speaking about poverty and wealth. Look at Africa. Look at South America. Look at North America. Here's a cartogram which illustrates why many people are probably concerned as to who's going to be the next president of the United States. And it has to do with world military expenditure. It's apparently one of the principal reasons we're concerned about international law and international relations. The knowledge economy. This is what it really looks like. And finally, what all of us in this room are implicated in. It's the generation of knowledge. And this is the Times Higher Supplement's top 200 universities and their intensity of location. Well, fortunately for this country, the Netherlands is looking pretty good. But the rest of the world, I've got my worries, right? But a terrestrial, geometric understanding of how the world works has its problems. And we've been part of naturalizing it as international lawyers. So, different materialities at play, have international lawyers been ignorant to them? Maybe I've been giving the field a short stick. Things have been changing. The standard explanation is as follows. We see the normative structure of the rule of law in the world moving into three dimensions, not two. Now, for some, that's big news ever since the announcement of global administrative law. The idea now is that international law and domestic law as fixed systems can no longer cope because of these materialities which have been at work, which I've been illustrating to you. And this has been leading to the development of new public-private forms of global rule. That's been the big news of the last 10 to 15 years. And the best examples that I can give you are, for example, the Basel Committee. Banking policy has to be coordinated, but we send up these informal working groups where the top bankers of the world make standards that tell you how you should run your monetary policy. But it's not based on formal international law. Or something that touches more of us in a scary kind of way, and this is based on the research of Marieke de Hooden and Gavin Sullivan, which is the privatization of security lists and how there are companies which now produce and trade risk lists of, well, at least 1.5 million people. So public-private cooperation and normativity developing transnational law. But there's a lot more going on, and that is that international law itself is changing. And it's changing with the introduction of the emergence of what we can call international corporate property rights. You've heard a lot about TTIP. You've heard a lot about TTP. That's what this is about. Bilateral investment treaties, transcontinental free trade agreements, establishing corporate property rights that can interfere with public policy. But further still, this complex materiality that we've been talking about in terms of how the world works is also leading to the most powerful actors in the world, such as the United States or the EU, leading to push their jurisdiction outward. And specifically here, I just give you the illustration of the United States in terms of how it establishes due diligence obligations with respect to forced labor, conflict materials. The EU is famous for its regulations on airlines. But that is dynamic, that is different, but I think the real change comes at the unit level. Let me explain it. It's the shift from jurisdictions to jurisdictions. And I explain it as follows, and I use the concrete example of drone warfare. Now, you can use also global value change as an illustration of this, but I think jurisdictions can be explained far more vividly with respect to drone warfare. Now, what do I mean by jurisdictions? Well, it goes back to the basic idea that we have a view of the land. And the way in which we view the land determines how we see it, how we see the vision of it. The understanding of how we view the land in traditional international law and traditional domestic law has been based on also something to say, which is a view, and that is jurisdiction. But there's a crucial difference. Jurisdiction is based on a geometric conception of space. It's based on a largely fixed conception of space. And it also understands time as being separate from space. Drones are a perfect illustration as to how that is all changing and how a particular technological object and particular sophisticated militaries in the world are able to change through a kind of open set equation the way in which force, authority is able to be extended in the world. So let's get more concrete in terms of examples. So, war. Typically, these kind of maps show up, and they explain the space of war. And here I've just put up as illustrations the Battle of Stalingrad, Operation Desert Storm. And it's based on two understandings. One, space is geometric, and that people are involved in the fight. And we typically see these kind of lines. And we map it on an absolute geometric space. There's a problem. Not just that space is not necessarily finite and fixed in terms of how we relate time and action to it and agency, but profoundly, the new levee en masse. And the new levee en masse are drones and robots. So the great revolution, one of the great revolutions of war was the French Revolution and the mass mobilization of people. Now, after the machine gun, after the tank, we're able to mobilize thousands of automated pilot vehicles, which are operating all 24 hours a day using infrared technology, using digitization to extend the application of lethal force throughout the world. Now, the transformation for war itself can be illustrated in this image. So you don't really have battlefields anymore. You have dronescapes, right? So dronescapes in the sense that these flying cameras, which require very little constant individual attention. They can be operated from far away in the world, hover for 24 hours over an area. They digitize the terrain. And in addition, they operate on algorithms. And so what takes place is a digitization of space and the ability to largely kill anyone you want on the Earth, provided you're one of the powers that can operate this technology. Jurisdictions talks about the legal and normative infrastructure which makes that possible and talks about how that disrupts our existing systems of international and domestic law. And let me just work in how the Anthropocene becomes significant in all of this, right? To really understand how space and time has changed and what Barrett calls the emergence of space-time mattering, right? So the operator of the vehicle is at Creech Air Force Base in Nevada. Using those undersea cables and satellite transmission is now operating in Pakistan, in Yemen, in Somalia. Technologies of extraterritorialization, which profoundly differ in our understanding of war from those original maps that I showed you of Stalingrad, Operation Desert Storm, or even the most recent invasions or conflicts that takes place. A fundamental transformation that some have called technologies of extraterritorialization. I think it's the emergence of juriscapes. And the important part here is this. Jurisdictions are based on a fixed geometric understanding of boundaries. Juriscapes understands them now mathematically as open equations, that they can expand, they can contract in far more creative ways than we've been able to understand up until now. And that's why some people call this type of warfare shadow warfare, precisely because of that, because of the open set nature, that it can, the lethal force can expand and contract very quickly, and you can have 24-hour surveillance and killing ability in the process. So, but let me give you this in the problem even further. So if we have the ability to extend our lethal military force in the world in ways that the geometric mapping of it has difficulty capturing, maybe we have to stop thinking in terms of geographies of war. And maybe now the only way we can understand what war means in its very new sense is through chronographies of war. So I have this short clip to illustrate what I mean. So, think back to the Battle of Stalingrad, to Operation Desert Storm, based on a geometric understanding of space and its separation from time. The Anthropocene has changed that, and it's changed that because it's created what we can call space-time mattering. And in the context of war, we have to turn to time to capture the interventions, to capture the potential violations or breaches that take place. The lines on the map have their limitations. We have to draw new lines. We have to find new maps of capturing them, precisely because we've changed the world. It's terrestrial operation, it's practical operation. And what that means, however, is that the structures, doctrines, normative systems that we have understood to be fixed and stable are doing what history has always told us. They're not. They become stable and they become unstable. Actual materialities become potential materialities. And then what are the implications then for knowledge? International legal knowledge, international legal rule. Well, the first thing is we have to take a serious look at the first slide we often show to our students, which is this is apparently international law and this is reality. The problem with this system that is emerging with potential materialities is that increasingly this is a more narrow sphere of rules that govern the world that have consequence. And it's a binary way we teach our students, which is this something is international law or it's not. But increasingly, the activities of consequence, materiality, geography, is bringing this under stress. And more of what's happening in the world in terms of conflict, in terms of wealth, in terms of inequality, is being lost in terms of this binary system. We need to really talk about a quantum legality in the sense that there are different, just how there are different potential materialities in the world, there are also different potential legalities. And we look at different events, different statements. We look at the way ontologies present them. Languages become wrapped in it. How different legal rules, techniques, iconographies become involved. Political agendas, ideologies, ethics, construct legality, not law. Fundamental change that we need to introduce to the way in which we say how international legal rule functions. But there's a problem, and I'm sure there's some people in this audience who'd say, not so fast. And there's some credence to this. This term discipline is a funny word. It has three layers of meaning. The first one is a descriptive noun. The second one is, in the Foucauldian sense, disciplining. We are told what the right research questions are. We're told what the problems are within a field. And that's because of this, the theological element. Scholars, students come together and they believe that they have a world of their own. And that world of questions and problems that they focus upon really are more important than the stuff the other people in that geography of knowledge are doing. Which means that what I'm talking to about could face resistance. Which means that, hey, the church is the church. You're either on the choir sheet or you're not. The text that I'm handing out to you at the end of this, my presentation today, which marks my inaugural lecture, says that that's wishful thinking, that the theology will keep the different questions and the different ways of looking at the world and thinking about maps problematic. There's three reasons for that, and there are three dynamics. The first is that if we look at what is a discipline, and we look at interdisciplinarity, historical epistemology tells us that all throughout time, going back to the ancient Greeks, we've always been categorizing knowledge. But those categories and the hierarchies of knowledge that we've placed have never been stable. We've presumed in our present time a stability because at the turn of the entry of the 20th century, we had universities institutionalize departmental degrees, and those departmental degrees created scholarly markets. What has become clear to us since the Second World War is that that institutionalization of particular degree structures and particular scholarly programs break down because of political epistemology, because of what we're all familiar with as well, research funding. And increasingly in a knowledge, so-called knowledge society, universities and disciplines are losing their monopoly over determining the questions that practice needs to focus on and that policy needs to focus on. And so what I propose in the text is I'm saying that when you look at these three dynamics in the formation of disciplines, change is going to happen because it's been shown over time. Now, this brings me in contrast to the map of, or the geography of knowledge I've shown you previously. Instead of talking about imagining knowledge and disciplines as these discrete, almost territorial structures, the fact of the matter is that we're profoundly interconnected. Here on this map, you can see law is here, next international studies, sociology, economics. The interconnections between our fields are so profound. And one of the objectives that I wanted to show you with geography was to just show you how deep the geographic assumptions are, how quantum mechanics points out to us that we have certain assumptions about materiality which have to be addressed, even though they're not on the canonical syllabus. And to close, my grade 5 school teacher told me that you should never read to your audience, have mercy on them, unless you're a preacher. But I'm in a robe, so perhaps I can read to you what is the final paragraph, which I think summarizes perhaps a challenge to the field as a whole. In sum, what this lecture has sought to do ultimately is explain to international lawyers how interdisciplinarity is not a choice, label, or singular project owned by a particular scholarly agenda, but rather a historical and strategic reality of the still evolving conceptual, institutional, and political map of knowledge ordering. What is more, interdisciplinarity now becomes a crucial aspect for our research and teaching curriculum, pivotal for the field to grasp and remain relevant to new patterns of socio-legal organization that realign international legal rule considerably beyond what the interstate model has insisted was global legal, political, and economic reality. The manner in which international lawyers now address this interdisciplinary challenge will determine in the end whether our students, as well as a stakeholder public, identify in italics, and this is a credit to Nikonov, what we do, as either curating the institutional model of 1945 or engaging the considerably evolved state and complexity of legal rule in and over the globe in the 21st century. To reframe that challenge using the parable bluntness of Friedrich Nietzsche's words, Perhaps the moment has arrived where the discipline reflects upon the ambit of its empirical, normative, and methodological presumptions, so that our Facebook-following students do not quietly and metaphorically ask with Zarathustra what's pondered. Open quote. Could it be possible then, question mark, this old saint in his forest has heard nothing about Vattel being dead? End of quotation. That concludes the substantive portion of my lecture today, but there is a tradition of thanks, and there are many thanks to give for having this great privilege to be able to share my ideas and to have this great privilege of being part of the community here at Tilburg. And, well, thanks has to be said in many languages. The rector most notably pointed out that languages in our household are a constant juggling act, but so is university life. The first thanks that I want to give are to my colleagues, my newly befriended colleagues at the Tilburg Law School and in the department. And you might say, what's a chess piece doing there? And actually, I have a funny story from that. I had a student come in my office and said, do you really play chess or are you a poser? And I said, probably both. That's the way life works. The reason I show this chess piece is for the following story. 12 years ago, I decided I didn't want to be a commercial practicing lawyer anymore. And it was a difficult decision. It was a leap of faith. And at that point in time, my brother went to Mexico and bought me this hand-carved chess piece. And he said, I know everybody's asking, what are you doing? How are you living? And my father, as my mom knows, was racking up all the hundreds of thousands of dollars in foregone income I had put to the side. And he said, I know people are asking questions and wondering why you're doing this. And he said, but I know one day you'll find your office again. And he said, and the day that comes, I want you to put it in it. And so in January of this year, I took that chess piece out of that box and I put it on the desk. And that is a tribute to the welcome, the warmth, the enthusiasm, and the excitement that I have received from my colleagues. I won't list the names because that's just, you know, a recipe for running into an ambush, having missed somebody by mistake. So I won't go in that way, but everybody knows the great people involved in all of this. And I say that having been and had colleagues in great places as well. And I think that's a tribute to how you've welcomed me here, and that's my great appreciation. There are also my friends, both professionally, sometimes it's professionally, and also in the most colloquial of friendships. I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for the camaraderie, the team spirit, the sense of mission that I've shared with so many people, both within the vocation and beyond the vocation. I just want to take this opportunity to just thank specifically a number of people that have been here today, Nick Onuf being one, Harm Skapel being another, Walter Werner, Tanya Alberts, the list goes on. But as we can all appreciate, in our journey to try and fulfill our dreams, there are certain people that see some faith in you or see that they want to invest some faith in you. And I want to say thank you to those people, because I wouldn't be here right now if it wasn't for that faith that you invested in me. And I'm deeply conscious of that, and I want to thank you for that. Then there's Anya. And there's another story. The road to this chair was one that wasn't a road at all. It was probably more like those air routes that you saw on the Anthropocene that I was showing you about. I think within the first 2-3 years of finishing my PhD, I was at over 200 flights at some point. And at one point, Anya and I we were married, but I was working in Seoul, South Korea, and Anya was working in Brussels, and I was commuting. And at one point, I remember Anya and I were sitting in a plane. I think we were flying back from Thailand or something like that. And Anya watched this film called The Time Traveler's Wife. And after the film, she said, you know, that reminds me of my life with you. You just kind of pop up and disappear all the time, and which was true. And I want to thank Anya very much for putting up with the time traveler, and putting up also with putting the faith in me and in my belief and my conviction of that this is what I want to do and this is what motivates me, despite all the naysayers that were along the way. So thank you very much. To my family, foremost to my mother, unfortunately my father couldn't be here to see this day, but I think we will remember him. I mean, he is still alive, but we will remember the persona that he once was, and I'm sure that if he was sitting in this audience, he would be very happy to see that I took what you as a mother and a father told me, which was that you should pursue education to its fullest. And I think I took it a little too seriously because you checked me in on, and I remember this day very vividly, you checked me in to school 37 years ago and I haven't left. And I'm certainly that's caused you some stress, but I think both you and Dad can know it's going to be okay. And then finally, to my kids, or our kids, to Alexander and Victoria, who will be joining you later, but I think Anya and I can both agree that to be able to speak like this in many ways requires the humility that we've learned from our kids and the way they've taught us how we get corrupted as adults, and we forget some of the finest things in life, and we're so grateful to them every day. On that note, thank you very much for your time, and I hope I have rewarded your curiosity. Oh, you go this way? Yeah.
Every second of it. Thank you very much. You have opened up a new dimension in inaugural speeches for the law school at least, and for the university following close to this. Your argumentation using elements from geography, quantum mechanics, technology, digitization, it's really flabbergasting. You showed us 53 slides in less than 50 minutes. You took us along all the different elements of the world, of the globe. It was really great to listen to it. And I'm very, very happy that you decided to open your chess box and put it in an office in Tilburg. Thank you very much. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's time to have a drink. So we are going to close this session. I would like to give the speaker and the cortege the opportunity to leave the lecture hall first, and then you can follow us and have a drink with us and congratulate Nick on his excellent performance. And before we are going to do that, I would like to close with a little prayer. And to this end, I would like to invite you to stand up. Leg gerust uw leven en alles wat uw hart bezwaart in de handen van degene die hemel en aarde bewaart, die wolken, lucht en winden leidt in de goede baan en die zeker de weg zal vinden die uw voeten moeten gaan. Dank u wel voor uw aanwezigheid.